today is the day, at least one of the days, I guess. Today is my pre-op appointment for my breast reduction surgery. If you guys didn't watch my first video kind of explaining like why I'm getting this surgery, you can click the link in the description because that kind of goes through everything. Today we decide how small I want to go. So currently I'm a size triple D, double D. I don't know if that's very accurate, so I'm going to ask them to size me. But I want to go down to like a C. Maybe a small C, I don't know. Some people that have gotten breast reductions before, they like don't love their results because they think they're still too big, and I don't want that to happen to me. So I feel like going smaller would be better just because I have heard that they do grow back, you know, like maybe if you get pregnant or if you're on your period, I don't know. So I'm just gonna ask him like all the myths that I hear online and see if they're true. Also, a couple people on Instagram DM'd me with their questions, so I'll have him answer that. Hopefully, I don't know if like he'll be in a rush or anything, so hopefully I'll be able to film. The place I went with was Westlake Dermatology. If you guys are in Austin, you already know who Westlake Dermatology is. I feel like they are so well known. I was honestly shocked by their pricing because I called around to a bunch of different plastic surgeons here in Austin, and some of them could have gone up to like $14,000. Westlake Dermatology was honestly one of the more affordable ones, which was very shocking to me because they're Westlake Dermatology. It is 8:47 a.m. right now and my appointment is at 9, so I think I'm just gonna go in. I might have to do some paperwork, I don't know. So let's do this, I'm so excited. If you're in the process of losing weight and like getting healthy, should you wait until after you get it done? Like how much will it affect your weight loss mm-hmm. and all that kind of stuff?
Yeah, so ideally, like as well as with like breast reduction, also with a lot of like liposuction cases as well, is that you do want to be like at your ideal weight.
Yeah.
Like kind of course weight fluctuation.
Yeah.
Fluctuates all the time.
Yeah.
But ultimately that would be the goal because then your breast can kind of accommodate to that.
Right.
And kind of be at that ideal shape you want them to be.
Going off of that, like let's say I get my period, like are they going to get bigger? Like, you know, during pregnancy I've heard that they get like a lot bigger.
Mm-hmm.
What do you think?
Yeah. So, I mean, of course, everything that typically functions with your hormones with your breast after a breast reduction or an augmentation, anything with that will still remain intact.
Okay.
And so ultimately, yes, they will fluctuate
yeah.
as well with your period or pregnancy and everything.
So does that mean like I should go on the smaller side when getting them done? Because I've heard a lot of people getting them done and they say that like they wish they went smaller, like
mm-hmm.
they were just still too big.
Mm-hmm. Not necessarily. I mean, ideally, for example, for you, like,
yeah.
what is your current bra size right now?
Honestly, would you be able to size me?
We don't do that, unfortunately.
Okay. I don't know. I think it's like a triple D, double
okay.
D. I don't know.
And what would be like your dream? What's
like
the goal?
C.
C, yeah. Is it more so like you're set on a C, or are you saying like you want just something to kind of fit your body frame,
yeah.
ultimately?
Yeah.
Okay.
And like, I like that I have like in tops, in certain tops, like I like that it fills it up.
Right.
But some tops, it's just like too much. It's like
yeah,
spillage
it's
or like they don't even fit in the cups. So like
mm-hmm.
something that like just fits better and
yeah.
stuff, you know, like
exactly.
I like having boobs, but it just like doesn't.
It's just a lot of boobs.
It's just a lot. It's just a little too much.
Yeah,
so.
No, I understand that. And so, I mean, I wouldn't say to just like go for the smaller just because
yeah.
of normal body
right.
habits of period and pregnancy and stuff like that. I think really the key is getting it to fit your shape and your body frame and something
okay.
that you're comfortable with ultimately. Because then the same things like with your period, like, I mean, they might get bigger, but just it's not a lot
yeah.
really in this
okay.
kind of things. And pregnancy wise, that is a bigger fluctuation compared to your period, but it's not forever
yeah.
too. It's really just for that time.
Okay, going off of pregnancy then.
Mm-hmm.
What about like breastfeeding? That was like my mom's biggest like
mm-hmm.
issue, concern, like just like you have to be able to breastfeed.
Nowadays, like because
yeah.
before there was a lot of, especially with like breast augmentations getting an implant, a
yeah.
lot of patients were super stressed about that kind of thing.
Okay.
But now there's the technique of placing it under the muscle has helped make it to where people with augmentations can have
okay.
breastfeeding.
Okay.
And of course with any surgery, there we can't 100% guarantee, yeah, but we try to make sure that you will have that opportunity. So
yeah,
in regards to a breast reduction,
yeah,
yes, you should be able to. But as with, like I said, any surgery, we want you to know that there could be a risk.
Yeah, yeah.
That might not be.
Yeah. And I just found out that apparently not even everyone can breastfeed. So like,
yeah, no,
I didn't
true.
Even know that.
Yeah. I mean, it's, of course, everyone, like, they want to take that initial step too and then
yeah,
realize that it might just not be in their cards and ultimately
yeah,
have to do bottle feeding. And I mean, there's nothing wrong with that. So,
right.
So.
And then, so like a lot of people have been like, oh, I'm just going to wait till I have kids to do this.
Mm-hmm.
My issue is like, I don't know when I'm going to have kids.
Right.
Like, it's just like getting later and later.
Right.
So do a lot of people with breast reductions like come back like 10 years later to get
mm-hmm,
another one, or like what does that?
I mean, everyone's so different
yeah,
with it, truly. And I mean, like you said, like people do want to wait
yeah,
and everyone has that time frame with it, like
yeah,
with augmentations and getting implants. There's people that 100% are like, I'm not getting them until I have kids.
Yeah.
People can come back, you can get an implant exchange, and
yeah,
I didn't want to wait that long.
I didn't, yeah.
And everyone, yeah, that's their personal decision.
Yeah.
And really, I think you're at kind of the age where it's really the optimal time with recovery and everything, and
yeah,
you want to enjoy them too.
Yeah.
You want to like have the time to feel like you're not having like this huge weight on your shoulders
yeah,
and like be able to wear the clothes that you want to, because
yeah,
you're in the age of 24
yeah,
to do those things.
Yeah, yeah,
not
totally
just, but it's everyone's personal decision. And
yeah,
for those that do get it earlier, like, I mean, you might come back like
mm-hmm,
10, 15, it's,
yeah,
10, 15 years, but also you might be super content with it and
cool,
don't have to come back.
Let's
so,
hope for that.
Really, for sure.
I know there's like a kit that you can buy for like scarring,
mm-hmm,
but are there any like, you know, like laser sessions that you recommend for scarring, or like
mm-hmm,
have, like, do you, I mean, I guess I have to take like real good care of them to like make them go away.
Mm-hmm.
Will they go away like completely if I do all of that,
mm-hmm,
or like will there still be like some kind of?
So do you know what the scar?
The anchor.
Yeah, so it's an anchor. And a lot of, I've realized with patients who have kind of more darker skin tone, there's more of a risk of keloiding, which is usually what we recommend, or like hyperpigmentation of those scars. And we recommend for you, maybe before starting what's called even tone correcting serum. We have it here in our clinic. Starting that, it's just a moisturizer.
Even tone?
Even tone,
okay,
yeah. It ultimately has 7 like melanin blockers that are gonna help prevent that hyperpigmentation.
Okay.
Scar care is really, really important, especially
yeah,
with this procedure, just because it's a little bit more of an invisible
it's a
scar.
Lot. It's a lot. I was watching YouTube videos.
Yeah, and a lot. And there are some patients who just don't want to do this procedure because of that
scar. Yeah.
But I've seen a lot of patients who do the scar care that we recommend,
yeah,
and really it does wonders on them.
Okay.
If there does come a time, typically it's usually at your like 2 to 3 month mark where
yeah,
you feel like they're still like raised, they're just
okay,
not settling, because everyone scars differently.
Yeah,
too.
Yeah.
There are people that have like huge scars that just don't
right,
go away. Some they go away after a couple months or so.
Yeah.
We do have laser treatments for that.
Okay.
Typically, we'll usually recommend what's called Fraxel. It's a great procedure really just for overall skin correcting.
What is the cost of that?
So, and we're typically for Dr. Chikiobi, because
yeah,
it's for a procedure he did on you,
okay,
it usually costs like $50 a session.
Oh, but how many sessions?
We usually recommend like 3 sessions of it.
Oh.
Yeah, it's not crazy.
Okay, I'm gonna need
yeah,
that.
No, it's great. And I mean, you might not even
not
need
it,
but
okay,
if there comes a time where you're just like still like,
okay,
I just want these to kind of go away faster.
Do you not recommend, like, do you recommend like waiting like that 3 months? Or
I
like, can
wait,
you get it done
out?
Like,
wait like 2 months
two
at
months
least
to
just off, to first start the scar care, see
yeah,
the process with that, and
okay,
then I can take it from there.
Cool.
Yeah.
I feel like when I was doing like research, there wasn't like, everyone was so vague about it, you know, so I want to be like super in detail and like go through like the whole process, because
yeah,
I've been thinking about getting the surgery for like years, so I'm just
yeah,
really excited. And, I mean, the thing is like, I've grown up with big boobs this whole time, so like I don't know what the difference could be, but I'm just like, since I do videography and photography, like I'm always like standing up holding a big chunky thing, and like then my back's hurting, you know, so much.
Right.
So now I've like realized like, okay, it could be the boobs, you know. Also, tell me if one boob is bigger than the other, because I'm very curious. I feel like it is, but it's
yeah,
normal to have
no,
that, right?
you took like 10 women and looked at their breasts, you noticed that like 9 of them probably would have one side bigger than the other, and more commonly it's the left side bigger than the right. So let's see if you're kind of in that kind of demographic. I think this is the case. Yeah, your left breast has more volume, kind of sits a little wider on the right side, and there's more volume on the bottom. So
weird.
There was a bit of a trade-off with breast reduction surgery in that your new shape will be awesome, but also come with some scars.
Yeah.
And there is a typical scar pattern that that I have to create. You know about your research, so you know how it goes. I think that scars can be a bit more of a concern for so-called ethnic skin. So someone with Asian heritage, Hispanic heritage, African American heritage, those patients, I tend to be very obsessive about their scars because there's a bit higher risk of scar issues.
Cool.
Yeah, the downtime from breast reduction surgery is not bad compared to most plastic surgeries.
For the areolas,
yes.
like, do you decide on the size?
I typically will make them roughly 34 millimeters. The real name is areola tone, but we call them cookie cutters.
Yeah.
So we're talking about cookie cutters. I'm taking a bit of it.
Yeah. Take it off.
So we have these areola markers, areola tones, and this is how I determine areola size during breast surgery. In the past, we would use one that's even bigger, but over time we realized that wasn't super aesthetically pleasing.
Okay.
Any questions for me?
No, I don't think so. Cool.
Okay.
All right, thank you so much.
You're welcome.
My pre-op went really well. It was pretty quick, honestly. I got all my questions answered. Now we're going to talk about pricing. I know everyone's very curious, but it's kind of like a more controversial thing to ask, I guess. The whole surgery was about $9,900. And what I found was really interesting was that the lift was the most expensive part. So the breast reduction was only like $1,000 more. And they explained that the lift would actually remove a little bit of the tissue. So if you only got the lift, you would go down maybe around a cup size. But they said if you wanted to make them even smaller, go ahead and get the reduction while they're in there. So I obviously did, because I definitely want them to be like a good bit smaller than what they are now. My first video where I explained why I want this surgery, I also explained why I'm not going through insurance. If you have ever looked into getting a breast reduction and getting it covered by insurance, you would know that it's such a process and it just like didn't work out for me. So unfortunately I am paying it out of pocket, but I already know I'm not gonna regret spending this money on the surgery. So I made a $200 deposit, and then when I went to my pre-op, I made a payment of $7,350. And then the rest of the money you actually have to pay to Austin Surgico, which is the anesthesia people, which was around $2,000. Some other things to keep in mind that might cost extra. I had to get some blood work done, and that was around $80, but my mom just told me that I could have put that under my insurance, so I think we're gonna like submit the receipt and get that figured out. Once you go to your 1 week post-op, they give you the option to purchase scar kits and other things that can help you heal faster, extra pain medications, all that kind of stuff. I also had to purchase my own zip-up bras, so you just need a bra that zips up in front or buttons in front. I thought the zip up would be easier, so I went ahead and ordered them on Amazon, and I can link those below. You basically have to sponge bath like a week after too. So I bought some disposable like sponges that kind of like get soapy when you wet it a little bit. Another thing to note is that I will be having some drains. I don't know if they're giving me two drains or one drain, or I've never had drains in my life, so I don't even know what the heck that is, but I have to buy gauze and hydrogen peroxide for that. It's basically there to just remove any excess fluid. I have the paperwork that they gave me, and I'm just gonna read through like some pre-op and post-op instructions. So first, no smoking for 2 weeks prior or 2 weeks after, in case you're a smoker. And then it says, please do not consume alcohol, aspirin containing products for at least 10 days prior to your surgery and 14 days after your surgery. I was actually curious about this one because I was like, dang, can I not have like one margarita? So like I Googled it, and basically it said that it needs all of the body's energy to just like focus on healing your body and not to focus on like your hangover or healing your body from like dehydration from alcohol. That's what I kind of got from it. So I don't know how strict like the 10 days prior thing is, but I definitely probably won't be drinking 14 days after. It also says that it could just increase bruising, which obviously I don't want. So they said to shower with antibacterial soap, so Dial, And then just do not wear any moisturizers, makeups, perfumes, deodorant before your surgery. That's one thing that got me too. I was like, oh my God, I'm literally going to be so nervous. I'm going to sweat. And then it's like nervous sweat that smells. She was like, you're going to be fine. So I was like, okay. Wear loose fitting dark clothing to your procedure. They recommend button up shirts. And they also told me to wear sneakers, not any like flip flops or anything like that. For post-op, you're supposed to keep the incisions dry for 24 hours. For 2 to 3 weeks, you're supposed to avoid bathtubs, jacuzzis, pool, anything that will have your boobs submerged in water, which sucks. It is the end of summer and I love to go swimming, so I'm gonna have to get all of my swimming needs out before the surgery. They said to leave any tape covering on the incisions for 1 week, just like have them take it off at your 1 week post-op. It says to wear a soft bra with no underwire for at least 4 weeks after surgery. Avoid strenuous physical or aerobic activity for 2 weeks. For 4 weeks, I'm supposed to avoid heavy lifting greater than 15 pounds, and I'm free from all exercise restrictions 6 weeks post-op. I'm supposed to avoid raising my arms over my shoulders for 2 weeks, and I should avoid laying on my stomach for 6 weeks. It also says to minimize sun exposure to incision areas for 6 months to a year, which I feel like they're always covered, so I feel like I won't have a problem with that. I'm not sure if I mentioned my doctor's name, but I'm going to Dr. Chikiobi at Westlake Dermatology at the downtown office. And at first I thought I would have to get the surgery done at like some random surgery center, but they actually have the surgery center in their downtown office, which is kind of nice. I guess the next vlog you'll see will be my actual breast reduction vlog and the recovery and all of that. I'll be sure to make a playlist on my YouTube channel in case you are researching getting it done yourself. Feel free to follow me on Instagram where I'll be posting real-time updates on my stories, and I will see y'all in my next video. Bye.